Based on the symptoms that you've explained to us,
yes.
Have you seeked help,
mm-hmm.
Especially professionally, or who did you talk to? How did you go about it? Maybe you can just share that with us.
Yes, I have sought help,
mm-hmm.
in two different ways. The first time I did that was through my friends,
mm-hmm.
just telling them that I'm not okay.
Mm-hmm.
And the reaction I was met with was, you know, you'll be fine, don't worry about it, pray
mm-hmm.
about it,
mm-hmm.
You know, let go,
mm-hmm.
and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And, but I think deep down I still felt I needed more.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did was I went to my mom,
mm-hmm.
and I told her that I need help specifically from a counselor.
Mm.
So she got in touch with a few. We
mm.
settled on one.
Mm.
And in April 2015,
mm.
I went for my first session
mm.
with this counselor.
Mm.
And after that, I got my, I think the first session that I went for, she just and I just gave her my history,
mm.
what I've been through,
mm.
trying to give her an idea of where I was at the time
mm.
in terms of my mental health.
Mm.
And then I got an assessment
mm-hmm.
to do, a written one.
Mm-hmm.
So in one go, you had to just answer like about 150 questions.
Yeah.
After that, then is when I got my diagnosis,
mm-hmm.
which was depression and anxiety disorder.
Mm-hmm.
And my journey towards, you know, becoming better
mm-hmm.
With regard to my mental health started that time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's between April to August 2015,
mm.
and then I stopped for a little bit because I felt like I was doing a lot better.
Yeah.
So I was able to stand on my own and, you know, face life and all its challenges, because
yeah.
challenges never go away.
Yeah.
And then later that year, 2015, I think about November,
mm.
Something triggered again,
mm.
and I had a relapse.
Mm.
So I tried to get over it, but I wasn't too successful.
Mm.
So early 2016, I went back to the same therapist,
mm.
and resumed my sessions,
mm.
but I think 2 months or so in,
mm.
I felt that we were not really clicking,
yeah.
and I needed more.
Okay.
Because my episodes were more, you know, it's either I'm good for a bit,
mm.
and then I'm not so much after some time, and then
mm.
back up, back
mm.
down. So
mm.
that vicious cycle was something that I really wasn't comfortable with.
Mm.
So what I did
mm.
is I reached out to my friend's late mom, who connected me with a psychiatrist.
Mm.
Now with a psychiatrist, the difference is that they deal specifically with the brain,
yeah.
the chemicals in the brain,
yes.
you know, the chemicals that get you feeling happy, get
yeah.
you feeling sad, angry, and all that.
Yeah.
And deep down, I thought my situation, just my own perception,
yeah.
my situation was one of those that maybe would need medication
mm-hmm.
and therapy combined,
mm-hmm.
not just therapy alone.
Yeah, yeah.
So she introduced me to a very good psychiatrist
mm-hmm.
who works at the Aga Khan Hospital,
mm-hmm.
and she gave me 3 hours of her time.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, consultations that doctors usually rush through in
yeah,
10,
yeah.
15 minutes.
Yeah.
She gave me 3 hours, and yet she had patients that were waiting
yes.
After
wow,
me.
Wow, that's really nice.
You know, and
yeah.
she explained so much. So
mm-hmm.
I got a very different diagnosis.
Mm-hmm.
So my diagnosis, according to her,
yeah.
was that I was suffering from PTSD.
Ah,
yes.
Okay.
So my PTSD was linked to, I mean, rather was a cause of emotional trauma
yeah.
that I'd
and
gone
is,
through.
What is PTSD?
Post-traumatic stress disorder.
Okay.
So
which is what we only hear from the movies.
Yes.
That a guy in the army has come back home
exactly.
and is experiencing PTSD.
PTSD
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
but I got to learn that through emotional trauma.
Mm.
You could suffer PTSD,
yeah.
you know, because I was never physically
yeah.
abused, whether sexually or physically,
yeah.
like being combated.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was never abused in that way, but
mm-hmm.
emotionally I was.
Mm-hmm.
I was taken through an emotional turmoil in the house I grew up in.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, after that diagnosis,
mm-hmm.
I think that's the first time that I really felt that there was hope for me
mm-hmm.
to get better.
Mm-hmm.
The doctor put me on some medication
mm-hmm.
while she explained
mm-hmm.
what the 3 pills that I was being told to take
mm-hmm.
a day.
Mm-hmm.
She explained what those pills were going to do. One was an antidepressant,
mm-hmm.
which was meant to raise my serotonin levels,
yes.
which is the happy chemical
yeah.
in your brain.
Mm-hmm.
It was really low.
Mm-hmm.
And so that medicine was just meant to raise that.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's another medication that was meant to help with my panic attacks.
Mm.
My panic attacks are very interesting. I don't, they're not extroverted.
Yeah.
Like you would not know if I'm having a panic attack right now if I was to have it.
Yeah.
I, because I'm used to bottling things on the inside, so I panic on the inside. So when my anxiety is triggered,
yeah,
I go into a panic.
Yeah.
But I don't go with that heavy breathing
kind of thing.
It's
yeah,
it's more on the inside. So my heart races and my chest just goes really tight.
Yeah.
So yeah, she gave me one to manage that. And then the last one is what we call she called it a blocker kind of thing.
Yeah.
So what it's meant to do, it's meant to, while the antidepressant and the pill for panic attacks, as they kick into your system, but they don't kick in immediately. What that was meant to do was meant to block any emotion that would have me feeling sad or angry, you know, beyond normal. So that was just meant to block that for, and I was meant to take it for just about 10 days.
Yeah.
So by that time, these other two medicines would have kicked into my system.
Mm.
And then now, once they do, she was she now referred me to a therapist that I've been seeing for about a year now.
Okay.
And yeah, that's with that therapist, I can say that we tackled quite a couple of issues that I'd been dealing with that I never knew, or maybe I kind of guessed.
Yeah.
And now I had to face them head on and deal with them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And now you've mentioned about medication.
Yes.
And we know the misconception that people have out there regarding medication.
Yes.
Some people will choose not to take them because of what they have had and not their experience.
Yes.
So what can you say on that based on your experience? And also what can you tell people who have been diagnosed or prescribed for medication by the doctor?
Yes.
What would you advise them?
Okay, to answer the first question, I was also one of those people who had misconceptions about medication. And I remember before I got introduced to the psychiatrist that I went to, I was very torn because within myself, I knew that I needed a boost. Therapy was doing good, yes, but I needed more. I needed more to help, to combine with the therapy to get me feeling balanced, so to say, even on a bad day. So I made a couple of calls to a few friends in the medical field to tell me more about, you know, people who have been put on medication with regard to different mental health illnesses that, you know, exist. And their explanations are basically centering on that when we have a stomach ache, we are quick to go to a doctor or whatever and get, whether we are you know, told that we have food poisoning, we'll take the medication to get rid of that food poisoning. A lot of our parents have high blood pressure. They take medication up until today. Diabetes, you go for medication. HIV, you go for medication. You know, and many other diseases that exist. So what about mental health? Mental health illnesses are just like any other illnesses. It's just that society has put them in a category of their own, to say that those who, you know, suffer from any mental illness are not, you know, are kind of, they're not, so to say, part of the normal society. But I had to get over those misconceptions because I had to accept I needed more help than I was leading on to believe. And so I got, you know, to this therapist and I shared my same misconceptions with her. And she explained a lot. She gave me, you know, a play-by-play of what different medications do for different people with regard to different mental illnesses that exist, because mental illnesses go beyond depression and anxiety. There's a whole lot more, you know. And so once she explained to me, then I was more comfortable in accepting the fact that, okay, I can take this medication. Now the other thing is that once you start taking them, the other, I think the one worry that people have is that, oh, will I get addicted to this medication? what I did is I spoke to my psychiatrist and I told her that, you know, I do not get addicted to this medication you're giving me. I also don't want to have an out-of-body experience.
Mm.
What I mean by that is, you know, when you take either drugs or you take booze, you tend to start feeling, you know, tipsy, then high, and then flat-out drunk.
Mm.
So I just told her that I still want to feel normal, but the medicine is doing what it needs to do on the inside.
Mm.
So a good psychiatrist will explain in terms of dosages what they should give you.
Yes.
You know, because some people I know have had bad experiences, whether because of misdiagnosis, and then which then has the doctor giving them wrong medication that has them lying in bed a whole day rather than being out in the world living a day. Because you're not meant to get medication to drug you.
Yeah.
You're meant to get medication to help you live
a normal
day.
Life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So for anyone who, you know, has any misconceptions, all I just say is have a chat with people who are on medication and also have a chat with psychiatrists that are there, you know, in the market, and tell them all the worries that you have.
Yeah.
Those who really know about their jobs, they will give you the honest truth pertaining to your specific case, because everyone's case is very different.
Yes,
so also when you are presenting your case in front of a doctor, it is very important to be as honest as possible.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, don't hide anything. Even that little thing that you think is not a big deal could be the deciding factor between your what type of diagnosis you will get.
Okay.
Yes.
Thanks for that. So as a man, based on your story and experience,
what
reactions did you get from people, say your friends, family, workmates, etc? What reactions did you get?
There have been a bit of a mix, both from the positive and the negative side.
Mm.
On the negative side, I have been told, there have been times I've been told it's all in my head.
Mm.
I'm imagining things. Everyone goes through challenges, and there's no way you're trying to tell me that your challenges are, you know, are worse than another person's.
Mm.
Everyone goes through, you know, things, and you just need to just deal with them, you know.
Mm.
On the positive side,
I
have had people, men specifically, who have come to me after I came public with my story. So I came public with my story on Instagram and Facebook, and a lot of guys came to me, or when I met them, like in social settings, and I'm like, and have come and told me that, you know, what you're doing is really helping a lot of people. The reason why they have not been able to talk about their own stories is because of fear of judgment. So a lot of them, what's coming out is that fear of judgment is what's very present in their minds, and that's what stops them from, one, seeking help, to just talking about what they go through in life with regard to challenges and whatnot. So when that kind of happens, I tell them, look beyond me. Yes, I have started the conversation, but I can't talk to myself. I'd like to talk to a fellow man and, you know, share my story with this person and have them share theirs with me, and loop in another person, and we, you know, before we know it, we have a whole, you know, chama of guys who would come together and not just talk about business, talk about cars, and talk about properties, and talk about money, and talk about women.
Mm.
We would have a group of guys who come and say that, you know what, yes, I'm in a marriage, or I'm in a relationship, either with, you know, an intimate partner, or with my parents, and it's affecting me in ABCD ways, and I find myself drinking a lot, I find myself being angry a lot, and any other thing. And we could now, you know, decipher positive ways of handling these issues so that we are all, you know, we are all living a much healthier life mentally to be present, you know, for those who may depend on us in any sort of way.
Okay. So to wrap it up.
Yes.
And, you know, I keep stressing on the fact that men,
yes,
because men do not speak out.
Yes.
So what would you tell your fellow men who probably have resonated with the symptoms that you've shared, or symptoms around mental illness, knowingly or unknowingly?
Unknowingly.
Yeah.
My advice to men is that always know you are normal. You are a human being.
Mm.
You're a human being who biologically was set up with feelings.
Mm.
And you can't run away from your feelings, no matter what you try and do, no matter how you try to beat the system. whether it's by being passive, by being in denial, by being violent, it just leads you nowhere. It brings you back to the problem itself. So acknowledge that there's a problem when you see it, and one very important thing to do is talk. Culturally, yes, we men have been taught to not speak about things that get us sad or angry, but I'd say that on the contrary, it's good to talk about your feelings. It's good to talk about things that upset you. It's good to communicate these feelings, because it's what gets you to be in healthier relationships, whether with your intimate partners or even with your workmates, you know, or with your family, and strangers out there, because I could be dealing with my own thing, and when I'm walking into the office and there's Kari, who has been saying hi to me for the past 6 months, he's just doing, you know, his due diligence by saying, oh, hi Edgar, how are you? And that day is when I go, I'm like, ah,
yeah,
habari, mzuri, you know.
Yeah.
And later on, you know, you realize, ah, man, he had nothing to do with, he did nothing to warrant that type of reaction from you. So it's important to speak about your emotions. If it gets to the point where you feel you need more help than just having friends and family around you, reach out to a psychiatrist, psychologist. They'll be definitely be able to help you, because there are some very good ones out here that can be recommended. And get that conversation going, because it's the only way you will get better.
Yeah.
You know, trying to do it alone has not gotten anyone anywhere.
If I
stand corrected, but I don't think there's anyone who has just gone through it on a solo mission and gotten out on the other side the right way, as opposed to, you know, either talking to a friend, you know, going through therapy. Sometimes maybe you need that your case, maybe you need to hear that your case is severe to a point that you need medication and therapy to be administered to you. So there's no shame. Shame is the one thing I think men need to come into contact with. There's nothing to be ashamed about. If you feel that shame, talk about that shame. You'll realize that after talking about it, there's actually nothing to be ashamed about. You're a normal human being who's going through normal things. So, you know, a lot of people will tell you, yeah, go to your pastor and pray and all that. But sometimes, I don't mean to I'm not in any way trying to say that I don't believe in God. I do believe in God. I do pray. But sometimes it's not the church that will get you out of that situation you're in. Sometimes it's medication. Sometimes it's a therapist. And being that person who will step up to the plate and say, hey, I think I need to seek extra help. And a lot of people have come to me on the side, you know, through social media or through the phone, and the text or calls, and they've told me, hey, you know, as a fellow man, I think I'm struggling and I need help. Do you have a minute to talk? Yeah, we'll talk. If they feel they don't want to talk to me for whatever reason, I point them in the direction of a professional who can take them through. And the results have been wonderful. Those who've been consistent with therapy, the results have been amazing, and their lives have changed around for the better.
That's really nice to hear.
Yes.
So, Edgar, I guess we've come to the end of this series.
Yes.
Thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you.
I know you're a very busy man. But
just a bit.
Okay, so
yeah.
But thank you so much. I'm sure people have learned quite a bit, both men and women.
Yes.
And I hope we will see you again.
I'm available anytime.
Anytime.
When it comes to matters pertaining mental health, I will create the time.
Yeah.
Yes. So anytime you have a question, you want me to interview again,
man,
just give me a call.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
You're most welcome.
Yeah. So guys, thank you for being with us for this series. And we hope you subscribe, and we shall see you in my next video. Goodbye.